Good afternoon. Thank you so much for joining us today. We're so excited to have Danielle Basye here with us. Danielle is our awesome dietitian at our Boise location, and she's going to talk about haze. And I'm excited for this presentation. It's going to be really great. So thanks so much for joining us. We just have a couple of housekeeping items to touch base on really quick before Danielle gets going on her presentation. So you'll see on your screen some bullet points that I want to go over really quickly. I should introduce myself. My name is Tamara Bingham-Noyes. I'm the Director of Business Development at Center for Change. I've been at the center almost 14 years, and it's my pleasure to join you all today. Okay, a copy of the PowerPoint is in the handouts section of the toolbar. You're welcome to print that out or save it if you'd like to reference it later. Obviously, you'll see Danielle's PowerPoint slides on the screen as she goes along, but if you need a copy, it's there for you to access. Also in that same handout section of the toolbar is a copy of the post-test. This is for reference only. In order to obtain continuing education credit, you must take the post-test online, and I'll talk about that in just a minute. You're welcome to submit questions in the questions section of the toolbar. We'll try to get to a few at the end of the webinar. We recognize that a lot of you are clinicians and have to pop off right at the top of the hour. So we'll get close to the top of that hour. We may go over a little bit if we have a lot of questions, but we'll do our best to get to a few at the end. So feel free to submit those in the questions pane and write those and send them, and I'll keep an eye on them, and then we'll circle back at the end with Danielle and ask some of those questions. When the webinar ends, there's an evaluation that pops up automatically on your computer screen when I end the webinar. That's a continuing education requirement for us. That's completely anonymous. So please feel free to be candid in that feedback. That's really helpful for us to know what was what resonated with you, and if there are topics that you'd like to hear about in the future, we tabulate those results and send them to the CE entities. So if you take just a minute to fill that out at the end of the webinar, that would be wonderful. And then about an hour after the webinar ends, you'll get a separate email to the same email address that you registered with. That email will have a link in it to take the online post-test. Again, you must take the post-test online in order to receive continuing education credit. Once you pass the test online, then your CE certificate will automatically be downloaded to your computer. If you don't see it on your screen, check your downloads file. Sometimes it hides in there, so keep an eye out for that. Okay, I think we are ready to roll, Danielle, so I'm going to turn this over to you. Let me make you the presenter coming your way.
Okay. How is this looking, Tamara?
I can see your whole screen, so you need to just start the slideshow from the beginning. So you just have one slide up.
Okay. My computer's kind of freezing, so I think it should be. How is it looking now?
Not yet. I haven't seen a change. Shelly, do you see something different than I'm seeing? I see your, there we go.
Okay, yay.
I would just maximize your screen. Can you do that?
Well, thanks for bearing with us, the technical difficulties.
It's always something, so that's okay. Like I just see, there we go. There you go. You're good to go. Okay, I'm going to shut off my camera and my microphone, but if you need me, I'm right here, Danielle, so just holler and we'll let you take it from here.
Awesome. Cool. All right. Well, welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. I appreciate you. I know, especially for me, I know we're all Zoomed out, so I really feel honored that you're joining us today on another online platform, so I appreciate it so much. So this presentation is called Health at Every Size's Role in Healthcare. So to start, I will go over a little bit about me, just so you know who's presenting to you. Okay, so this is me. I use she, her pronouns, and I would classify myself as an anti-dietitian, which I'm super proud of, even though it's a mouthful to say. I'm also a yoga instructor, so I use these principles not only in my professional work, but also I would say teaching yoga is a wonderful hobby that I have, and so I try to bring these principles into teaching movement for everyone. In my spare time, I always think it's fun to know something interesting about the people who I see present. I have two beehives in my backyard. Me and my partner harvest honey every year. Last year was our first, and we got about 2.5 gallons of honey just off one hive. So this year we're expecting more. So we're going to have more honey than we know what to do with. And then I love sushi and tacos. And if I had to pick two foods to eat forever, those would be it. So that's just a little bit interesting things to know about me as we go through this presentation. So you feel like you know me a little bit better. Okay, so just some objectives I've listed here. Obviously wanting you to know some of the health at every size principles that we'll go over. And I'll use the word HAZE as shorthand for health at every size if you've never heard that before. I want to go over some misconceptions of health at every size. I think it's really important, especially if you're new to learning about health at every size, or even if you're not new to this concept. These are just some misconceptions that I've come across through my career that I think are important to go over to kind of debunk these misconceptions. And then obviously talk about weight stigma, evidence-based interventions that support health at every size and reducing weight stigma, especially in the healthcare setting. Okay. And I love questions. So Tamara mentioned we'll get to questions at the end. I really miss presenting in an in-person format because I love having discussions. I like to know my jokes are well received. So please ask questions as we go along in the question box, and we'll circle back around to that at the end. So just to go over some terminology as we go through this, I'm really trying to focus on bringing awareness of returning to patient-centered language. I think that is so, so, so important in the health at every size HAZE paradigm. And it's not one of the principles of HAZE, but I think it's really important and is a key component as we move through this presentation. Another term that I'll use is diet culture. And Christy Harrison, if many of you probably are already familiar with her, but she's a wonderful dietitian who wrote the book Anti-Diet and has a podcast called Food Psych. And this is her definition of diet culture, which I think it really sums up what it is in a nutshell. So diet culture is a culture that worships thinness, and weight loss is equaling a higher status. It demonizes certain ways of eating and really oppresses people who don't fit in this ideal that we've socially created. So I love this definition. So talking about language and person-centered language, I've kind of created this graph of, instead of saying this, this is kind of the way that we want to shift to be more inclusive in our language, especially in healthcare. Obviously, I understand that BMI categories have to be used in a medical documentation or for insurance purposes, but I really like the language on the left of a person in a higher or lower weight, person with a larger or smaller size body, full figure, plus size, smaller, large frame, or higher or lower end of the weight spectrum. I've also seen people use a person who has diabetes or who has obesity or who is in the overweight category. Just really creates more of a person-centered feel around it rather than saying someone who is obese or an obese person. I put fat on both sides of this because it just really depends on the person. For a lot of patients that I've worked with, fat has been a really demonized term. It carries a lot of trauma in it, especially around bullying, what they've heard themselves say or what they've heard other people say. And so when you're working with clients, you really just kind of have to find out through talking to them what kind of language they prefer you to use as you're talking about different body shapes and sizes. So these are a lot of the terms that I will attempt to use throughout this presentation, and ones that I invite you to use if the health at every size paradigm is something that you're interested in including more in your practice. Okay, so the definition of health at every size, or HAZE, is supporting people in adopting health habits for the sake of well-being rather than weight control. So we all know that health is a continuum that is very unique on an individual basis. And so this whole paradigm or way of thinking is really trying to provide access to people of a wide variety of sizes, the opportunity to engage in health promoting behaviors. Not only is it used for individuals, but it's really also meant to encourage and helping inform policies that directly affect those who are being stigmatized on a body shape or size basis. So most of the information that I have on here comes from ASDA. So this is the Association for Size Diversity and Health, and they are the organization that has the registered trademark for HAZE. which I think happened in 2011. Don't quote me on the date, but they did a registered trademark so that it couldn't be used for dieting or any other weight loss propaganda. And so they've created these principles, these five principles that we will go through. And so they're kind of like, now that they've had the registered trademark, they've kind of set the standard on what exactly health at every size is. Obviously, there's lots of information about this movement, but this is a standard that I was going to use. If you're interested in more, they have lots of great resources, journal articles and curriculum. So they're a great place to go for more information. I also wanted to mention that health at every size, or the essence of fat acceptance or health at every size, has really transformed over the years. I would say, from my knowledge and my experience, starting in the 60s with fat acceptance, especially with women of color, and kind of has adapted and changes to where we are now. So just wanting to offer gratitude for those who have come before us, for what we know health at every size is now, as it's kind of taken form over the years. Lindo Bacon, who published Health at Every Size, the book, is also a kind of a groundbreaking. So you might have heard some of their work as well. Okay, so the first principle is health enhancement. Obviously, in Health at Every Size, we're talking about improving health and well-being for all people. So ASDA defined it as improving access to information and access to services that support physical, mental, social, and spiritual well-being, and also supporting health policies. So when I'm working with a client or an individual or talking to a healthcare provider about health, I really love bringing the definition of what health is. The one that I love and prefer is the World Health Organization's definition. And they define health as a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. And I like telling people and sharing this definition because I think in our Western world, we have this social constructed idea that health means being free from all ailments. And, you know, when we're only focusing on that physical part, we really miss so many other areas of health that really make us whole as people, that make our health holistic. And so I really enjoy this definition, especially when supporting health policies. We know that it's not just physical health that's important. And so we need policies that really promote and provide access to mental health, social health, because we know the impacts that those have also on physical health. So something that I do with my clients, for those of you who haven't done this, this is kind of an idea sparked by Jessica Setnick, who's a wonderful dietitian in the eating disorder field, is having clients, or even yourself, is kind of fun to do. This is one that I did for myself, about what does your health pie look like? And when for people who are visual, when we only focus on the physical part, other areas suffer. So if you're only focusing on moving your body, what you're putting into your body, making sure that you're in physical tip-top shape, your social health might deteriorate, your mental health might be impacted. We can only do so much. We only have the mental capacity for so much, so that something has to give in order to put so much focus on that. So I think this is a great representation of, you know, what are we missing out on? What do each components of health look like, and what do they include? I've done this a lot of times with patients, and I've even had patients do like wanderlust health because like being adventurous and traveling was really important to them. And so I love seeing what each person does because it's so individualized and unique that it really, I think, depicts what a person is as a whole. Okay, the next one is weight inclusivity. So this is really trying to advocate for a weight inclusive approach versus a weight normative approach. And so obviously a weight normative approach would be using weight as a sole indicator of status or health. ASDA defines it as accepting and respecting the inherent diversity of body shapes and sizes, and not trying to idealize a certain body shape or size, or pathologize a specific weight or body shape or size. Intuitive eating, this comes, it's inspired by that, is recognizing and honoring the genetic blueprint. I always say in my presentation that if my mom showed up and we were both to stand in front of you, you could tell that we were related. We're both short, we both have hips and thighs, and our body shapes are very similar. Now, I know that's not everyone's experience, but it's unrealistic for me to expect a different body shape when it's in my genetic code, my DNA. And so we really have to work as healthcare providers and advocating and educating our patients and other providers that, you know, there is a genetic DNA that we just really can't fool and can be difficult, if impossible, to change. Part of weight inclusivity, especially in healthcare when BMI is so rapidly used because it's cheap, it's easily accessible, and it categorizes people. When someone has a BMI that they are upset with or having a hard time accepting, you know, I like to educate them, especially about the change in BMI and, you know, why it's not a really great indicator for health reasons. So in 1998, I didn't know this until I started this job and was doing more research on health at every size, but they actually changed the BMI category. Linda Bacon writes this in their book, Health at Every Size, in 2008, of overnight, the NIH and WHO wanted to have congruent BMI categories. And so one of them switched, I believe it was the NIH, switched the standard. So overnight, millions of people went from the overweight to obese category and vice versa. Not really based off, you know, evidence-based, but mostly to have congruent scales. And so kind of, you know, picking apart and having a critical eye to have great little tidbits to educate clients on, I think is really important. And I always like teaching people things. So that's a great little tidbit to take away. The next one is respectful care. And this one, I feel like there's a lot of controversy or misunderstandings about health at every size, but I feel like this is one that we can all agree on, providing respectful care. So this one really emphasizes acknowledging our own biases and working to end weight discrimination, weight stigma, and weight bias in our work and the care that we provide. We all have our own biases. If you grew up in this generation, we grew up in the same society. And so, you know, we've all been culturally influenced and have our own biases and have carried those into our work. I'm still unpacking mine. That's why supervision is a great space. My clinical supervisor will gently redirect me or offer me new language or a new way of thinking. And it's really important. And so I love this about the eating disorder field, as there's so much camaraderie and teamwork, which is really helpful as we attempt to provide the most respectful care that we can for our patients. And again, in this area is also being respectful of that we know that socioeconomic status, race, gender, sexual orientation, age, and other identities really influence health. And so we need to be respectful of how we are creating our treatment plans. What are we offering to clients and patients by keeping these things in mind? Because when we don't respect these things, we're really not offering individualized care. And so it's extremely important to identify these inequities and create an individualized care plan, not only for individuals, but also on a policy level basis. We aren't experts of other people's bodies or lived experiences. And so I like to throw this in here because I think that's a huge, huge piece in respect and kind of goes back to, we all have our own biases. We all have our own experiences, but we will never know what it's like to live in someone's body, live in someone's life. And so I think that's just a huge part of offering that respectful care. And then again, I can't recommend supervision or teamwork enough. And having that safe space to process your own biases and to talk about things in a way that helps us move forward. Because I think it's really important to have that safe space, because if we don't ask questions, if we don't have conversations, it's going to be really challenging for us as a profession to move forward with these new principles and ideals if we aren't able to talk about them and get perspectives from those around us. So this one is a really important piece that I would say that most people agree with working in the healthcare field. Okay, so one of mine, this is my favorite. Obviously, I'm a dietitian, so I'm biased, but the next principle that ASDA defines in health at every size is eating for well-being. And basically, their definition kind of sums up, in essence, intuitive eating. So promoting flexible, individualized eating based on hunger, satiety, nutritional needs, and pleasure, rather than for externally regulated eating plan focused on weight control. So basically, if you've read intuitive eating or know anything about intuitive eating, that very much aligns with that type of eating. This quote comes from my supervisor of using nutrition as a tool rather than a weapon. And nutrition is an ever-evolving science. It's not black and white, and people don't like that. People want, you know, answers. Do I eat this? Do I eat this? Should I be doing this or should I be doing this? And there's just so much that we don't know. There's so much new things that we're finding out. And so when clients come to me with, hey, I read on blah, 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 that I should be eating organic almonds 4 times a day because of X, Y, and Z, I say, okay, well, if that's important to you, how do we use this as a tool and as a guide rather than weaponizing it, creating shame and creating really rigid structure around it? And so it's really important, especially if you're a dietitian, to work with clients and patients and other healthcare providers on how can we use this information to promote flexibility and well-being rather than making our lives smaller, more stressful, and more rigid. There's so much culture tied to food that when we're doing a huge disservice to our world and to clients and individuals when we don't honor that culture that food comes with, especially when making nutritional recommendations or recommendations in eating disorder care or health policies. It's so important to keep those cultural components in mind. And then over on the right-hand side, the popsicle little icon, that there's so much more that food has to provide than just nutrition. And we really have to be keeping those components in mind, again, on a policy level, on an individual level. Again, when you go back to thinking about that, the entire component of health, there is an emotional aspect to health, or an emotional aspect to eating, because eating is emotional in nature. There's a social connection, there's a cultural connection, there can be a spiritual connection to food. And so we really have to look at that entire piece of the eating pie when we talk about making recommendations for nutrition or eating. Okay, so problems with weight-focused interventions. I just wanted to throw this one here on this principle because I think it's important to talk about and have people understand what is the problem with focusing on a weight-focused intervention. And I felt like this one slipped right into the nutrition one just because nutrition is one of the first pieces that people go to try to manipulate to focus on weight loss. So we just know that there's a very, very low long-term success rate. Most research shows that the success rate of long-term significant weight loss is around 3 to 5%, with a failure rate of 95%. I don't know many practitioners or people who like to buy a product that has a 95% failure rate, or a program, or anything really with that high of a failure rate. But yet we keep kind of going back to this idea that weight loss is the key, or that focusing on weight loss solely is the key. Which I think, again, goes back to how much societal pressure we have in this diet, living in this diet culture, of that we continue to go back to this this model of this weight-focused approach. Focusing on a weight-focused intervention increases the likelihood of weight cycling, which weight cycling is losing and gaining weight rapidly many times over the lifespan. And many people do this, right? And so we know that there is some health complications that can come along with weight cycling. We've seen research that shows that people who are dieting or who focus on weight loss interventions throughout their life have a higher BMI than their non-dieting counterparts. So if you kind of think about this quote unquote war on obesity, and we're trying to get people to diet, we're trying to get them to decrease their intake, move their bodies more, we're kind of fighting a losing battle from that perspective, right? So people who are dieting and are being told to lose weight and have all these interventions to lose weight to get a smaller BMI end up having a higher BMI in the future. So when I see that, I think there has to be something different that we can be doing if we know that there's such a low success rate when we focus on the weight piece. There's decreased body dissatisfaction. So those who participate in dieting throughout the lifespan are less satisfied with their body. They have lower self-esteem and lower life fulfillment than their non-dieting counterparts. It can put people at an increased risk for disordered eating, especially in adolescents. It's a huge indicator in adolescents, but also in adults, of the prediction of developing some sort of disordered eating or eating disorder diagnosis later in life, which we know is a huge problem. And it needs to be taken seriously, especially when there's so much focus on weight still in our world. And one that's also really important to me is that focusing on weight loss as an intervention really ignores basic human needs of adequate energy intake. And I tell my clients all the time, I don't care what size you are, you deserve to be well nourished through food. And so when we focus on weight loss through the restriction of energy intake, we are essentially hampering and potentially trying to deny someone of a basic human need and right of being adequately fueled. Okay, so I also put this one here on this one because it's something I like to do with my patients is when we're talking about health, of what are some of the crazy things that that are out there in the world that we're trying to do to promote weight loss? And is that really health? So up in the upper left-hand corner, the sauna pants, I just think it's really funny. I don't think this is like FDA approved or anything, but I just think it's quite funny of the things that we come up with and try to lose weight. The one in the middle is Spira Cyst. This one actually is FDA approved and is a reverse feeding tube. So again, really having a problem with prescribing people in a larger body eating disorder behaviors in order to lose weight. So a Spira Cyst basically is assisted purging through the stomach through a G-tube. Over here in the top right-hand corner, the blue glasses I thought was funny is a product that was created because nothing in nature besides blueberries that you eat is blue. And so the thought process here was if you wear these glasses all the time, everything will look blue and everything will look unappealing. Smart Bite down here in the bottom left-hand corner is a retainer to make it difficult for you to eat. In the middle on the bottom is the, I don't know how you say it, Obalon. And those are saline-filled balloons that they put in your stomach that's obviously here FDA approved to help with weight loss, to making the smaller gastric volume. And then I had to put Herbalife on here. If you love podcasts, Con Artist has a podcast about Herbalife and how it was created. To give you a little tidbit, the guy who started it worked for a dieting company, a diet pill company that got shut down, and then he created Herbalife out of the trunk of his car. And so it's a really interesting podcast episode. I love having these things for clients and practitioners because it provides a really great talking point too. So you're welcome that you have your next, when you can go out in public again and be with people, you have your next dinner party topic conversation. Okay, and so also I wanted to put in here for the nutrition piece is how do we teach resilience to clients? This one is so important. And I hear this all the time, especially in the eating disorder field, that you know, clients and patients do well when they're in treatment, they do well when they're surrounded by, you know, like-minded individuals, but the world is not, we're kind of a minority. The world is not like eating disorder treatment. There's not people, you know, all around you telling you and challenging diet culture. There's not people all around you not talking about weight loss. And so we really have to prepare our clients to be resilient in the world. Our culture is very slow to change. I do see a lot of change, but we still have so much more to do. So we want to give them tools to be resilient in a world that continues to worship this unattainable ideal. So I love showing research or talking about research articles, helping them advocate at the doctor's office, challenging social norms and ideals, and then giving them tools to advocate for those in their inner circle. That's one of the beauties of being an eating disorder treatment is that, you know, their community is attempting to adapt these, you know, these new ideals. And so it's a very supportive environment. But we want to give them tools to be able to do that in their circle that's not an eating disorder treatment. And I also put on here acknowledging the limitations to the body positivity movement. I think it's great. I think it's wonderful. Of course, I want everyone to love their body, but this really might seem out of reach for a lot of clients, and it can feel a little overwhelming, right? You see a lot of these body positivity people on Instagram or online who talk about loving every inch of themselves. They love their curves, they love their rolls, and how wonderful is that? But for someone who has struggled for such a long time with being at war with themselves and their body, it can seem like pretty black and white to get from 0 to 60. So just kind of talking about those limitations. And I also want to acknowledge this of people who live in larger bodies are going to continue to be oppressed in our society as we're trying to change. And there can be a lot of deep-rooted trauma continuing to live in an oppressed body. And those clients and people may continue to experience that same oppression and discrimination. I hope to offer a shining light in someone's life, but we can't protect people from a provider who is weight focused, or a friend, a loved one, family member, and a coworker. We can't protect them from those types of experiences. And so just acknowledging that as we're trying to get clients to be a little more neutral about their bodies, also knowing and understanding that they may continue to still experience that outside of your office. Okay, so the last principle, I always have a lot of information I like to share. So I know that I got a little sidetracked there. So now bringing it back to the last principle of health at every size, which is life-enhancing movement. So this principle talks about supporting physical activities that allow people of all sizes, abilities, and interests to engage in enjoyable movement to the degree that they choose. So if you love waking up at 5 a.m. and going to CrossFit, that's great. Not great for everyone. So really finding, there's not a certain way that movement has to look. And I talk to clients and people all the time about what actually the definition of movement is. And there can be a wide variety of what that is. So cleaning your house instead of having someone else clean it, raking the leaves, walking to the park. There's all types of movement that we don't particularly count towards structured exercise, but that do have physical benefits. And so helping people kind of undo that construct that exercise has to look a particular way is super, super important. We know that there is a lot of benefits to movement, not only on a physical level, but in an emotional health level, on a social level. And so we want to be able to provide that for people. People of different body sizes, abilities, or disabilities, we want to be able to provide equipment, services, and movement that adapts to all body shapes and sizes. I tell clients strength can be built at any size, and you don't have to wait until you're X, Y, and Z to begin doing a movement that you love in order to build strength. And we really want to create positive and sustainable practices. There was a research study done that compared a weight-focused exercise group versus a functional exercise group, so focusing on the function of the body. And the study showed that the people who were in the functional group rather than the appearance or weight focus group, those people continued with the practice, left with having higher self-esteem, satisfaction, and enjoyment compared to the weight control group. So if there's any physical therapists, weight trainers, yoga teachers on this webinar, I'm just being really mindful of language. And I've had to change and practice my language as well as I've adopted health at every size principles in my yoga teaching as well. Okay, so now that you know all the principles, which is obviously will probably be a test question, hint, hint, we're gonna go through some of the common misconceptions that I've come across working in this field. Is that you, Tamara? Oh, okay. I didn't know somebody had to tell me something.
Nope. It's not me, but somebody may be unmuted. So I'll go in and fix that. So you just keep going.
Perfect. Okay, so the first one that I come across is that Hayes people, they're anti-weight loss. Well, no. So if you're doing health promoting behaviors, weight loss might be a byproduct of changing the health behaviors. It's just no longer the focus. Weight is neutral. So just because, you know, if you lose weight, you're training for a marathon, you lose weight, it's just as neutral as if you're not training and you gain weight. So we're not anti anything besides anti diets. We just, weight loss is no longer the focus. There's a misconception that I hear that health at every size practitioners or the movement is anti-health, which I always find funny because health is in the name of the movement. And so the health at every size, what I like to say to people is just providing access and a shame-free environment so that people can engage in health-promoting behaviors specific to them and their enjoyment. Health at every size does not ignore the fact that exercise and nutrition do have an impact on health. I think that we have this idea of them impacting it more than it might actually, but just really focusing on, we do know that, you know, there's a lot of physical benefits from a wide variety of food intake and movement. It's just, it's not so much the focus because it's very individualized, and so we like people to make a choice that works best for them. For the dietitians out there, or anyone who works in the nutrition field, that I've heard a lot of people say that health at every size can't be used for people who have chronic illnesses that require dietary changes, so that it's anti-MNT or anti-nutrition.
Hey, Danielle, hang on just a second. We have you muted, so hang on just one second. Okay, you should be good to go. I'm sorry, we're trying to mute everybody again, and you got muted at the same time. I apologize.
That's okay. Okay.
You should be good to go.
All right, cool. So again, health at every size really aligns with making medical nutrition therapy interventions or using nutrition again to enhance health without making it rigid and controlled. And so I think that's a really big one that people might have the misconception that nutrition isn't thought about in a health at every size model. It is kind of in the way that we talked about as far as eating for well-being. So just like someone who has a peanut allergy, obviously we don't want to serve them a bunch of peanuts. Someone who is living with diabetes, there might be adjustments that we make based off their medical condition. Another misconception I hear is that it's anti-science, but I think that there's just a more critical eye. There's a lot of research and science has just advanced us so far, but really looking at and being critical of the research and how we use it. Again, using the information that we have as a tool rather than weaponizing it or using it to shame or demonize certain body shapes, food patterns, things like that. I often hear health at every size called healthy at every size. And so just acknowledging that we're well aware that not everyone is healthy regardless of weight. But I definitely think that the larger bodied population gets demonized more than I know a lot of people who live in a lower weight or are quote unquote underweight who have severe health complications. And so just something to be aware of if as you're talking to people about health at every size or using it in your practice, I just like to acknowledge both sides of the spectrum because I think that one side gets unfairly talked about more. Another one that I hear mostly from clients is that people who practice haze can't work with those who desire weight loss. And I always chuckle because I tell my patients, if I didn't work with anyone who came into my office who wanted to lose weight, I wouldn't have any clients. And so I think a haze practitioner can be really great to work with the client who potentially has a desire to lose weight. And just kind of unpacking, you know, what does that mean? You know, what are your reasonings? What are your values? And then offering them information as you work together, if they choose to work together, work with you. And health at every size just isn't just for people in larger bodies. So health at every size can be used in a wide variety of settings, in a wide variety of population. So basically, health at every size is trying to end weight stigma. Weight stigma is a discrimination or stereotyping based off a person's weight. It can impact people of a variety of sizes. Christy Harrison gave a great example of weight stigma or stereotyping when she had an eating disorder and wasn't really taken seriously. She wasn't completely underweight, but was in a suppressed weight for her, and her symptoms kind of went by the wayside. But definitely acknowledging that weight-based discrimination disproportionately harms those in larger bodies. It's often a barrier to eating disorder diagnosis and treatment, also a barrier to getting proper medical diagnosis and treatment. And it impacts all people, all genders, races, socioeconomic status, and education. Weight stigma, much like eating disorders, does not discriminate who it affects. And so this health at every size model is really trying to end this discrimination against against weight stigma or different body shapes and sizes. So weight stigma in healthcare, we know that, you know, our public health background, that oppression and discrimination have huge impacts on health, on physical health, mental health. It really seeps into all areas of health. When, if you go back thinking about that health pie I showed at the beginning, some of the immediate effects that they studied that show up in healthcare is that medical providers, a lot of the studies have been done with medical students or medical doctors, but that providers spend less time with people in larger bodies than they do in their thinner counterparts. So already out the gate, just based off the size, based off the weight in the chart, medical providers are spending less time with patients in larger bodies. There's a belief that they'll be less compliant. So the education that healthcare providers give people in larger bodies varies significantly to the education we're providing their counterparts. So they get less time. The education's different because there's a belief they'll be less compliant. There's an increased negative experience both on the patient and the provider side. And for the patient, it impairs cognitive functioning and ability to communicate effectively. Which is huge, right? We want, you know, everyone says advocate at the doctor's office. You need to advocate, ask questions. But if you're experiencing oppression, discrimination, the way that you are able to think and communicate to someone in power changes drastically. And so we really have to be taking these components in mind. And this is why ending weight stigma is so important in educating people about it, because it's really impacting the way that we deliver healthcare. I always give myself an example of I declined to be weighed at the doctor's office. I live in a pretty average body, so up front I don't experience weight discrimination. And I work in this field and live, breathe, eat haze and eating disorders and intuitive eating. And I still get anxious declining to be weighed and asking questions at the doctor's office. So I can only imagine what it feels like to someone who has been shamed their whole life in a healthcare setting, what it must feel like to actually experience this in the doctor's office. Some of the long-term effects of weight discrimination in healthcare, there's high levels of stress, high levels of cortisol, which we know impact physical health. Those living in larger bodies wait longer to seek out healthcare, so that will impact our abilities to provide preventative care and treatment. They avoid healthcare settings in general. They place a lower value on health than their thinner counterparts, have lower self-efficacy, and they seek out weight-focused treatment more, which we talked about some of the health impacts of yo-yo dieting. And then there's just some internalized stigma, which has the greatest impact, believe that one deserves a discrimination. And again, they feel less confident in health-promoting behaviors. Okay, so just giving some real life examples of weight discrimination in the healthcare setting, because I always find it really powerful hearing other people's experience. I have a lovely patient who gave me consent to share this story, and she's just really touched my heart. We've been working together for a while, wanting to establish primary care as she had moved from out of state, has a long history of restriction, had a current diagnosis of binge eating disorder, a lot of emotional eating. She currently lives in a larger body and has most of her life and has really struggled with weight acceptance. We finally got her into a doctor's office to get labs, to establish care, had a terrible experience. The lady, the medical assistant, asked her if she was here because she had bulimia. So again, up front, kind of discriminating against, you know, not everyone in a large body suffers, you know, from binge eating disorder or doesn't have a history of restriction. She met with the physician who she told me was lovely, very kind. She told her this story about her struggles, what she was trying to do. And at the end of the treatment, based off no medical indicators, recommended bariatric surgery because she was so motivated and eating disorder treatment. So again, just really, you know, I don't think that this provider meant any harm. I truly believe she felt like she was doing the best that she could for the patient. But again, without having any medical implications, this patient has beautiful lab values, great blood pressure, other biomarkers are great. Just again, focusing only on the weight component when providing medical care. The next one is my lovely sister, who also touched my heart. She's lived in a larger body most of her life, has been bullied, has been stigmatized. She's had heartburn and digestive issues pretty much her entire life. She was told by a medical provider at the age of 19 that she was very pretty but had a round face, and attempted to sell her weight loss injections to help with her heartburn and nausea. No one really talked about mental health with her or other lifestyle behaviors. They all recommended low carbohydrate. And she recently lost weight due to some lifestyle changes around 21 years of age. And that was the first time that a physician offered her or referred her for an endoscopy. And now she was diagnosed with gastroparesis, and now, you know, tends to eat higher carbohydrate foods because it feels the best for her. And so we're just really missing the big picture when weight is the only focus. Appearance and body shape and size don't belong in medical care. Appearance has nothing to do, right? So we really need to get back to the core and the beauty of the healthcare profession and really set these biases and stigmas aside in order for us to deliver the utmost best care that we can. So thank you to both of those beautiful ladies who allowed me to share their stories. So I just always think it's really important to hear from people that what is their experience in their story so that we as providers can learn. Some of the most common biases that I see come up that I have done myself or just in general have seen in the community, using the potential of weight loss to encourage a client to eat. When I first came into this profession, I thought this was, hey, great, there's a client, I'm trying to get them well nourished. And you know, sometimes when people start eating, their weight can change. But really, again, then we're focusing on the weight and that weight loss should be a motivator and it shouldn't. Changing a meal plan based off weight gain alone, this one has been hard for me because I see my clients panic and I panic for them because I care for them. And so really trying to dig down as a clinician and focus on why am I changing the meal plan up or down or whatever, what have you. Feeling anxiety when patient is gaining weight. That's kind of your own bias as well, which just happens to me before. Not providing all interventions to a patient with atypical anorexia versus anorexia nervosa. This is a huge one. I consider atypical anorexia just anorexia with weight stigma. And so wanting to give the best care to anyone based off their body shape or size. I won't go through all of these, but they're worth reading. I just kind of put them on here just to kind of give you a tidbit or some things to think about as you're working in the healthcare field. I think they're important to note. Okay, so what does the research say about health at every size models in health? So health at every size has been shown to improve depression compared to dieting counterparts. There's a decreased drive for thinness, increased body satisfaction, and there's less body image perception disturbances. So people who are practicing from a health at every size model don't get as bothered or have as many body image disturbances compared to someone who's actively dieting. Those who have an intervention for a health at every size model eat more for physical hunger and satiety cues. So there's more incidences of people eating in a more intuitive eating type of way. Improvement in metabolic biomarkers. So A lot of LDL, triglycerides, cholesterol. Again, there's limited research in this area, and I'll go over research gaps as well. And there's increased pleasure in eating and decreased stress around food. And as a dietitian, I love anytime someone tells me they get pleasure from food and there's joy around food, because I think that is so important and really underestimated when we're talking about health, that there should be pleasure and joy in eating. And I think we should promote that more. So the citation on the bottom of this was a really great randomized control trial, and a shout out to a dietitian in Ketchum, Mariah, who gave me this article. And these are just two lifestyle programs, public health programs that were studied. And this is one of the only randomized control trials that I have personally found that's up to date. And so just kind of give you an idea of what a public health program would look like from a Hayes approach and what one would look like from a dieting approach. The HUGS program is the Health at Every Size program. And the LEARN was obviously the weight focused one. And I just kind of like to put them side by side, because in some ways they're very similar, right? So working on, you know, eating for well-being, hunger and fullness, working on physical activity and joy and movement. But I just like so much more on the health at every size side. Like, they also include personal enjoyment, life fulfillment, accepting your body shape and size, rather than, again, on the dieting size, using a lot of those external things such as weight loss and calorie prescriptions and attempts to lose weight. So I think it's really important to know, like, especially on a policy level, like, what are we striving for? And these are the differences in the two things. A lot of them have, you know, there's some similarities, but obviously there's vast differences in how we approach these. This article is a fantastic article. It really looks at a lot of the biomarkers as far as health outcomes. And so I would highly, highly recommend reading that, especially if you're providing education to other people or clients or other healthcare providers. It's a great evidence-based article. Okay, so I felt it was important to talk about what are some of the gaps and limitations to Health at Every Size research. I've read recently there is some critique that Hayes perpetuates healthism, so that it only focuses on health self, but hopefully I gave you a picture of that there's so much more to it than just the pursuit of health. Long-term data, as in anything, I feel like is lacking. Obviously, again, like anything, it lacks diversity. So there's a lot of Health at Every Size articles that focus on women, college students, so younger people. So there definitely needs to be more research. So hopefully there's people on this call that are willing and able to do research on Hayes, because we need it. You can't control for internalized stigma of participants living in a larger body. So someone who has dieted their entire life, there's going to be things that are just out of the control of research in itself. I think people really want specific health metrics. And so I think that's something that should be studied more as well. Again, Hayes from specific health conditions. I've started to see more of those come out as far as working with someone who has diabetes and other health conditions. So that's definitely an area that needs some more research. The research, I also know there's misunderstandings on what Hayes is and how to use it in practice. And probably the biggest research gap or limitation is that the standard way to measure studies is through weight loss, which again perpetuates weight stigma. And so it's difficult because the measure of success in a study for many, many research studies is weight loss, which doesn't align with the Health at Every Size model. So what can providers do? Just to kind of sum up, pay attention to your language, using larger body versus obese or obesity, even when you're talking to peers. It's not just around clients. So really changing the way that you talk, because it really does influence people. Look at your own biases. We all have them. You're not a bad person because you have biases. But they're just, it's important to note so that we can do the best work possible. Don't admire or praise weight loss and assume that someone's doing well. I just heard heartbreaking stories of most of the time when I work with clients and they get praised for weight loss is when they're doing the worst. I've heard people praise weight loss when they've had a cancer diagnosis or had a miscarriage. And it's just something that we shouldn't do. So again, in your personal life, professional life, refraining from admiring or praising weight loss, and maybe redirecting people that you hear in your inner circle when they're admiring or praising weight loss. Again, focus on the health promoting behaviors. Have inclusive material for all genders, body types, and eating disorders. We just really want to be inclusive of all. Doing continuing education, having a critical eye to research, offer to educate others. I used to be terrified of public speaking, but this is just something I'm so stinking passionate about that I love the opportunity to talk to other people about it. Practice what you preach. So again, taking the health at every size model and advocacy, not only in your professional life, but in your personal life, can be really powerful. And help and offer to support clients with other healthcare providers. I don't think that most people who enter the healthcare profession want to help people. And so again, just having conversations with other people who you might notice might need some redirection or education, or just having a conversation with, can also be really powerful. I put this on here, obviously we don't have time to watch. This movie makes me cry every time I watch it. It's a beautiful TED Talk by, his name is Dr. Anita, and just his experience with how he's treated clients in the past in larger bodies. I've watched it with clients, I've shown it in group. It's a great conversation starter, and I just think it's a great resource that I wanted you to have, even though we don't have time to watch it. I put other resources on here as well. If you are new to this field and need some other tools in your toolkit, obviously intuitive eating is great. Linda Bacon wrote Body Respect, Health at Every Size. They were published as Linda Bacon. Radical Belonging is Linda's new book, and it's absolutely phenomenal. This book talks about, again, those coping skills and resiliency tools to live in an unjust and an oppressive world. Anti-Diet and the Body is Not an Apology by Sonia Renee Taylor, and she recently came out with a workbook as well. And then there are some podcasts. And I always like to end on this because I know that there's a lot of questions and concerns about health at every size being used in the healthcare community, and empathy, respect, and humanity will foster better healthcare. And I really feel like that's what the HAZE model encompasses. And I would say most of us can agree on that. So I'd just like to end on that note. From the presentation. And thank you so much for joining me. I know it was a lot of information. I'm a fast talker and I like to get a lot of info out. So Tamara, I'm going to change it back to you.
Thank you. We have a ton of questions, so which is great. So we'll try to get to a few of those. Before we do that, because I know some folks have to hop off right at the top of the hour. So before we get to those, let me just remind you about a couple of things. Number one, when I end the webinar here in just a few minutes, an evaluation will automatically pop up. If you would be so kind as to fill that out, that would be helpful for us. It's a CE requirement for us. It's completely anonymous, so feel free to be candid in your feedback, and then we tabulate those results and send them to the CE entities. And most importantly, about an hour from now, you'll receive a separate email from a GoToWebinar with the link in that email to take the online test. You must take the test online in order to receive continuing education credit. Once you pass the test online, your CE certificate will automatically be downloaded to your computer. If you don't see it on the screen, look in your downloads file. It could be hiding there. Okay, Danielle, let me get to, so of course these came in the order of your presentation, so we're going to go back just a bit and I'll try hard to not make it too confusing.
Okay,
first question, this is from Jamie. Jamie said, how do I do my part to act as a weight inclusive dietitian with my patients when your supervisor, some colleagues, and doctors focus on weight as one of the most important factors to the patient's health?
Oh my gosh, Jamie, kicking it off with a good one. I think in a professional setting, this is something I haven't experienced recently, because I've been honored to work at the Center for Change for almost 4 years, and we all use this model. But I would just continue to advocate with your patient, provide, every healthcare professional loves research. So really explain to them why you're doing what you're doing. I think advocating for, the patient's experience of, hey, I just want to let you know that so-and-so, while we were meeting, said X, Y, and Z, and I might offer a different suggestion. So I think just like having those kind conversations, but really sticking to your values offering to educate of like what you're doing in your practice as a weight inclusive dietitian, why it's important, what are some of the dangers of focusing on weight so much. And then have a community. If your employment isn't a source of community for you, and being weight inclusive, then I would attempt to find a community wherever you live so that you can get that support as well.
Great, thank you. Okay, Dory is asking, how do you suggest we separate health issues tied to weight, like type 2 diabetes or adrenal fatigue syndrome?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so actually that video, Dr. Anita, he actually talks about weight gain or living in a larger body actually being a symptom of diabetes, not being the cause. And so I think that, you know, there's so much misconceptions about weight and as it relates to diabetes. And so we can treat and manage, or not treat, or not, sorry, I was thinking of cure. We can treat and manage diabetes using health promoting behaviors rather than focusing on the weight piece. So if you look at, there's a lot of data that shows, there's one study, and obviously take it with a grain of salt. It was one study, a pretty small study, but they had people who had diabetes. One group got liposuction and one group had did health promoting behaviors. And so obviously the liposuction group lost weight. They had no change in their health markers. Those who managed it with health promoting behaviors like diet and exercise had changed. So I would say that we can always focus on health promoting behaviors without focusing on weight, even with medical conditions, if that makes sense.
Thank you. Okay. Michelle is asking, would you please remind her the name of the podcast about Herbalife?
Oh, Con Artist.
Con Artist. Thank you. Paula is asking, can you explain how you use the health wheel with patients?
Yeah. So I, Jessica Setnick has a video called What is Health? So that's a great resource. But I kind of just explained it like I explained to you. I talk about that the holistic approach to health, what are the components, and then I have them make their own. So I've done it with collage, I've done it with coloring, and I tell them that not every piece of pie has to be equal. So like I'm a pretty like introvert, so like social health isn't as important to me as like intellectual or like the spiritual health I have with yoga. And so that piece might be a little bit smaller just for me. And I think they change as well based off your life experiences, what's going on. And then in the health wheel, I have them write like when that piece of pie feels balanced, like what creates that piece of pie for you. So for physical health, maybe it's like doing yoga, cooking at home, going out with friends, trying new foods, taking my medication, seeing my doctor. And so they kind of come up with components that way when it feels unbalanced for them, they can go back and say, okay, if I want to focus on my mental health, like these are the things that I do that make that feel balanced. So hopefully that makes sense. If not, you can email me and I'd be happy to talk about it more.
Great. Alex is asking, what are your thoughts on haze in the pediatric population?
Like just being used in pediatrics.
I think that's what Alex is referencing. Is
yeah.
Younger population.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's a great model. You know, it's meant for humans. I think all humans. I think it's especially important when working with children because I think that weight focused interventions are getting started at a younger and younger age. So I think it's even more important to use this model with young kiddos and teaching them positive health promoting behaviors. Without the weight loss piece.
Thank you. Okay, we'll do one more. Samantha is asking, it's a long question, so bear with me while I get the whole thing up on my screen. Samantha is asking, what do you do when a medical provider is providing inappropriate / discriminatory care, like in the examples you provided? Do you contact the provider yourself and try to educate them? Parentheses, there is a power dynamic between RDs / therapists and doctors. What do you coach the client to do? Advocate for themselves? Find a different provider?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So in the example I gave in the presentation, one, we got teary-eyed together because I apologize for her experience on the behalf of the healthcare community. Then I asked her, I said, what do you want to do? Like, I'm happy to do X, Y, and Z. Like, what do you feel comfortable with? And they ended up writing a really powerful letter to the provider about their experience. And actually, which I'm so excited about, they said that this experience is motivating them to go become a PA or an NP so that they can provide inclusive care. So I felt like that was really powerful, and just offering like, hey, if you don't want to go back, like here's other referrals, or we can work with this provider if you like their personality. So really it's dependent on what the client wants to do and like what you're willing to do as a provider as well, because I can understand the power dynamics, and it's a difficult conversation. It's awkward.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you, Danielle. There are quite a few questions that we didn't have time to get to. So I know Danielle, I think on her last slide, has her contact information, her blog, and her Instagram and her email. So you all are more than welcome to reach out to Danielle directly and get some answers from her directly, and keep an eye on her social media. She has great information and great things to say. Thanks for joining us today. We hope you can be with us for our next webinar, which is on June 22nd. It's Sam Lample, who's an awesome clinician in Arizona. And he's going to be talking about adoptees and eating disorders, which is a really unique topic, and we're looking forward to that. So remember, keep an eye out for the webinar evaluation that'll pop up here in just a second when I close the webinar. And then about an hour from now, you'll get an email to take the online test. We hope you can join us next month. In the meantime, everybody, please stay well. Bye-bye.
Thank you.